And now your host, National Public Radio science correspondent, Ira Flatow.
Thank you. I'd like to welcome you all back to another season of Newton's Apple. Now, if you wonder about nature, if you marvel at science and technology or the human body, if you're just curious about the world around you, that's what we're here for, to answer your questions. In fact, that's why we chose the symbol of the apple, Newton's apple. No doubt you've heard the story of Isaac Newton gaining new insight into the pull of gravity by observing and questioning the simple fall of an apple. Now, we hope our program does the same thing, encourages you to discover the fascinating ideas that lie hidden among the simple occurrences in nature. We'll help get to the core of those ideas by asking and answering questions just like Newton did. So sit back and relax while we go to our first question. And this time, it comes in a letter from Kenny Arp of Dawsonville, Georgia, who writes, "Who was Dead Ernie?" Good question. Now, for those of you not yet acquainted with our skeletal friend Dead Ernest, here are just a few highlights of his career.
Now, I brought Dead Ernest on the show with me, and he has brought his small intestine along.
This looks like he had spaghetti for lunch.
Yeah.
Over the years, Ernie has helped us answer all kinds of questions about our bodies. He's shown us his funny bone, his diaphragm, his jaw muscles, even his tennis elbow. But Ernie has never been able to show us his face or tell us anything about his past. So we decided to see how much we could discover about Ernie's history using nothing but his bare-bone skeleton. Now, where to begin? Why not with the person who knows Ernie best, Dr. Jan Seary, biologist at McAllister College in St. Paul, Minnesota. Jan, tell us, who was Dead Ernie?
Well, Ira, we can't really tell who Dead Ernie was, but we can certainly tell a lot about him just by looking at his skeleton. So I brought him along with me, and he brought a friend of his, Bernie.
Bernie. Hi, Bernie. Bernie and Ernie.
Yep. Okay. We'll be back to Bernie a little bit later. Right now, a lot of people want to know, was Ernie real? Is he a real human being?
Is that real bone
yep,
there?
Yep, it is.
Okay.
He's wired together, and he has some plastic where cartilage was, but otherwise he's real.
Well, how did you get Ernie?
Well, you can buy skeletons from a catalog. We got him from
really?
Bought him from a biological supply company. Most of the skeletons that come that way to us are from Asia and probably India. And we can tell that too because he has dark stains on his teeth that are betel nut stains. He's been chewing betel nut, and that's common in Asia.
That's interesting. Now, I've always wondered, how do we know Ernie is Ernie and he's not Ernestine? You know? He's not a sheep.
We know he's. Okay, well, the best way to tell is by looking at the pelvis. So we're going to be looking at this area on Ernie.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I have a couple of pelvic bones, one male and one female, and I want to show you the difference.
Right.
If I sort of orient them so you can see what they're like here, and I'll tip them up a little bit. Now, the bone on my right there
this
goes right. It goes right straight down.
Oh, yes.
That's male.
That's the male.
If you look on my left over on the other side, that's a female bone, and it arches
more. Oh, yes. It's much more circular.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Now, the birth canal is under this arch.
This way.
Right. So the female has to be broader to allow that to happen.
Mm-hmm.
If we look at Ernie's pelvis, it's male. It has this male shape to it. And also, he has a much more rugged, bony structure to his head.
Yeah.
And so we know he's male.
What else can you tell us about Ernie? Can you tell us how much he weighed, how tall he was?
Well, he was about, just by measuring his bones, we can tell he was about 5'5". He weighed probably about 135 pounds. And we can tell how old he was when he died,
too. How do you do that?
Okay, well, we know, first of all, that he was older than 26.
You do?
Yeah.
How did you determine that?
Okay, well, the way we know that is the long bones of the body, in order to grow, have to have a cartilage plate in them, okay?
Mm-hmm.
Now, I brought this along to show you. This is the thigh bone, and down at the bottom would be, you see, the tip of this bone down here is not attached to the shaft when the bone is still growing. There's a space.
Okay?
When you get to be an adult, that fuses and it's completely bone. Now, all of Ernie's bones are fused. They're not growing any longer.
Right.
And the very last one to fuse is right here in the clavicle, and that happens at age 26.
Oh, so when his collarbone is all fused together, you know he's at least 26.
At least 26.
How do you know he's not much older than that?
Well, we did some dental analysis, and from that, there are changes in the teeth that go on as you age, and from that we know he died at about 30 or 35, not too old.
Could you tell anything about his health? Was he in good health when he died? Did he have any problems?
I don't know. know if you've noticed this about Ernie or not, but if you look at his backbone, do you see all these extra little bony projections here?
Yes, there are a lot of extra pieces of bone in
it. No, that's
there.
A disease. And if you look over at Bernie now, and Bernie has a normal backbone. Okay, there aren't
very
those
smooth.
Processes.
Yes.
He probably had a stiff back.
Did it make him walk badly?
It may have made him walk badly. Yeah, it's a possibility. We also know if you look at his forearm, there's a bump here, and that's
extra
where
bone.
And it isn't there on Bernie, and that's where the muscles that do this insert. And so we know he did this a lot during
his
life, or
this. So he might have done a lot of heavy lifting, or he might have been a carpenter, or something like that.
And we know that he was right-handed because that bump's bigger on the right than it is on the left.
Well, it's really amazing, Jan, how much you can tell just by looking at the bones of Ernie.
Yeah.
Thank you very, very much. And now for the pièce de résistance, because we're going to try to see what Ernie's face looks like. And here to help us is Dr. Michael Charney, director of the Forensic Science Laboratory of Colorado State University. Professor Charney, what did Ernie's face look like?
Before we can know what Ernie's face looked like, Ira, we have to determine what race he belonged to. Mm-hmm. And here we have Ernie's skull cast in plaster, mm-hmm. alongside that of a member of the Negroid race and a member of the Mongoloid race. If you look at the nasal structure on Ernie's skull, you'll notice that the nasal bones are narrow and hybridged, and that of the black are flat and broad. The face, the total face of the Mongoloid is very wide, whereas that of the Caucasoid is narrow. So that we can assume that Ernie belonged to, was a member of the general Caucasoid race.
And we know from Jan that he came from India. Okay, so we've placed him in the world and we know a little bit about his history. What about his face? Is it possible for you to take this skull now and to reconstruct what his face looked like?
Yes, because we have determined by taking the average of a large number of people, the depth of the soft tissue down to bone at 20 different landmarks, as you see on this particular cast of Ernie. Mm-hmm.
And these are the places on the face where it may be shallow on the forehead and a little more jowly and cheeky in different places
on
the face.
Yes.
And that's what these points represent.
They do. And in Ernie's case, we're dealing with the depth of tissue of a male. They would be slightly different for a female. We then connect with strips of clay going from one landmark to the next, following the contour of the bone, which is most important because it is the difference in the shape, the slight differences in the shape of the bony structure, which makes for the differences in the faces. Mm-hmm. And here you see the entire face built up by these strips. When that's finished, then we fill in the spaces in between with clay, and the entire face is now structured.
Well, not exactly the entire face. You have the eyes in there, but you haven't got the lips, you haven't got the nose. It's beginning to look very dramatic, but there are a couple of key pieces missing.
Yes, he is. The lips take a bit of artistry, and so do the eyelids. Mm. And the nose comes in very well because we know the curvature of the nose from the bone itself. Mm. We also know the width of the nose from the opening here, and we know the projection of the nose from a small bone at the base of the nose. And by adding all that together, we can come up with a perfect structure of what the nose looks like.
Okay, now for the moment we've been waiting for, actually, what Ernie looked like. Look at this. I mean, everybody at home who's seen Ernie as a skeleton is really in for a good surprise here.
This is a finished product.
What about his hair? Of course, he has no hair. How do you determine what that was?
Knowing where he came from India, most of the people there, the vast majority, would have black hair and anywhere from a slight wave to a curl.
Are there any newer techniques besides using clay that are being developed now?
Yes, Ira, there's the use of the computer and feeding it in through a video. And I brought a videotape along to show you exactly how that's done.
Okay, Professor Charney, what are we seeing here?
What you're seeing, Ira, is a CAT scan of a living human head.
In other words, a computerized X-ray of a real, live person?
That's right.
Okay. What are you going to do now with this X-ray that we're seeing?
You're going to have a computerized image of the living human skull in a three-dimensional view.
Well, that's what this rotating skull is. It's just the computerization of that image.
That's right.
Now, what do you do with this skull after you make this computer picture of it?
What they are doing now in medical specialty or plastic surgery is replace this soft tissue onto the skull so that repair can be done in those areas of the skull that have been damaged, either to the bone or to the soft tissue.
You mean like in fires or car accidents and things
exactly.
like that? Exactly. Now, what does that mean for you as a forensic scientist, though?
It's exciting to us as forensic science in science, Ira, because we hope to take this sort of information that have been gathered from hundreds of such people, the depth of tissue, and average it out, and then be able to take a skull of an unknown individual and put a face on it.
Like Ernie.
Exactly. Well,
that's very interesting, but let's say you can do all that, and let's say, you know, your facial reconstruction is a success as it is. How certain can you be that a skull like this really, in reality, looked like a real human being like we reconstructed?
When somebody comes along and says, by golly, that's Ernie.
Thank you very much, Dr. Charney, for allowing us to come face to face with our old friend Ernie. We'll be right back.